Students, today we are going to discuss the important topic of obstetrical emergency. We have previously been discussed postpartum hemorrhage, which is the nightmare of obstetrics and the main complication occurring in the third stage of labor. Today we are going to discuss some of the other obstetrical emergencies which fortunately have a low incidence, but the knowledge regarding their diagnosis and management is mandatory, thus to prevent a fatal outcome for the mother and the fetus. So the obstetrical emergencies are the life-threatening medical conditions that occur in pregnancy or during the labor or after delivery. So, which I want to emphasize you that an obstetrical emergency can occur in the antenatal period, like as you have been previously taught about the antepartum hemorrhage, eclampsia, during labor, as eclampsia can have fits during intrapartum. After delivery, which are the complications of third stage of labor. So an obstetrical emergency can affect in the antepartum, intrapartum and postpartum period. So an important complication which is fatal and about having 90% more than that of the fetal maternal, less likely to the fetal but the maternal morbidity, rather I would say more risk of mortality. Although incidence, alhamdulillah, is less, we are going to have a knowledge about the amniotic fluid embolism. Amniotic fluid embolism is rare. Most studies indicate that the incidence rate is between 1 and 12 cases per 100,000 deliveries. So how we define it? An amniotic fluid embolism is rare, but serious condition that occurs when amniotic fluid fetal material such as hair enter the maternal bloodstream. The body responds in two phases. So for the sense of ease, I would just like to emphasize you that always remember the first phase will be related mostly to the pulmonary outcomes. So now then you will not forget. The first phase would be related to the pulmonary outcome and the second phase would be related mostly to the cardiovascular status, as we will see. So in the initial phase, one of the pulmonary vasospasms causing hypoxia, hypotension, pulmonary edema and cardiovascular collapse follows. So rather you can say that it would show like initially as a strong anaphylactic reaction, because amniotic fluid is a foreign body, you can consider it as a foreign body for the maternal bloodstream. So the second phase sees as the development of the left ventricular failure with hemorrhage and coagulation disorders and further uncontrollable hemorrhage. You can see in this picture, this is just a representative diagram so that you have a clear view. The amniotic fluid can enter into the uterine cavity through a breach into the uterine wall. So it can be as such, you can see there is a breach in the interface between the uterine wall and the amniotic cavity. So due to this breach, you can see that the amniotic fluid can enter into the maternal circulation. This is the amniotic fluid and it can enter into the uterine circulation. So a defect in the membrane or a defect in the uterine wall can allow the amniotic fluid to enter the maternal bloodstream. So this is also a diagrammatic representation of the effects which we are encountering. Exposure of the fetal tissue to maternal circulation, which can lead to activation of inflammation. And the first response will be this, that is like an adult respiratory distress syndrome. It can lead to hypoxemia, right heart failure, left heart failure, leading to it, and thus then hypotension. This hypotension can cause neurological injury, and in the other cascade will be of the disseminated intravascular coagulation, which can lead to bleeding. And bleeding can also further aggravate the hypotension, completing this vicious circle. So the first response will be mainly pulmonary and followed by the cardiovascular response. So these are the presumed etiological factor. I would say there is no definitive etiology for non-acute embolism, but these are the presumed factors, or you can say rather for the etiological factors, these are the risk factors. In these ladies, we can have a more risk of amniotic fluid embolism with these factors. And these are not the definitive etiological factors. So a maternal age of 35 years, previous cesarean or instrumental vaginal delivery, because in these cases, we suspect there is some fibrosed area in the uterine wall or in the internal aspect, which can be breached during this manipulation and during this delivery, or with the uterine contractions or with our instrumental manipulations. So a polyhedral mass can have these effects, a cervical laceration, previous one or during this labor, or if God forbid the uterine rupture happens, which we are going to discuss later as well. There can be placenta previa or abruption. Amniocentesis, if a procedure of amniocentesis is carried out, eclampsia, abdominal trauma, ruptured uterine or cervical vessels due to the application of any instrument or because of any tears which can happen due to the strong uterine contractions, the ruptured membranes. So these are most of the risk factors which can lead to the amniotic fluid embolism. So what would be the signs and symptoms? Definitely, as I told you before, that the first cascade of events which we expect will be pulmonary. So definitely the signs and symptoms will be also related to the pulmonary system. So there can be a sudden shortness of breath, as also happened in an anaphylactic reaction, excess fluid in the lungs, sudden low blood pressure, and this could lead to a sudden circulatory failure, life-threatening problems with blood clotting and DIC. And because of now, as I told you before, because of this altered mental state can happen because of the hypotension, and hypotension can also lead to nausea or vomiting, chills, rapid heart rate, fetal distress, seizures, and coma. So how we are going to diagnose it? Always remember, amniotic fluid embolism, rapid and abrupt fluid diagnosis can lead to the safety of mother. Otherwise, we are going to lose the mother. And the clinical diagnosis of these signs and symptoms, keeping in mind the risk factors, would be your key event for diagnosis and for the prevention of this catastrophic event. And if this happens, for the safety of the mother and to save her life. These diagnostic modalities can help you further, but mainly always remember the clinical diagnosis, keeping in view the risk factor and the sign and symptom which just happens to the patient, and the presentation are your key helpful module to save the mother. Always remember. And in this case, we are very much short of time. Either you recognize the events in first 2 to 5 minutes and you are going to save the mother, or otherwise if the hypoxic injury to the brain or the lungs happens or the cardiac failure happens, then the things becomes irreversible and the maternal mortality is unavoidable. So, but the diagnostic modalities which can help us can be an X-ray chest, which may show an enlarged right atrium and ventricle and prominent proximal pulmonary artery and pulmonary edema. Lung scans can help. Central venous pressure is an initial rise due to pulmonary hypertension and eventually profound drop due to severe hemorrhage. Coagulation profile will definitely be disturbed if the patient enters into the disseminated intravascular coagulation. And the features of disseminated intravascular coagulation, we know by the laboratory investigations, as you have also discussed in postpartum hemorrhage, would be definitely a prolonged PT and ABGT, decreased fibrinogen and fibrinogenemia, and also FDPs, the fibrinogen degradation products, will be increased. On the other side, the cardiac enzyme levels may be elevated, and the echocardiography will also reveal a left heart failure, acute heart, right heart failure, or severe pulmonary hypertension. So how we are going to manage? This is an obstetrical emergency where our time is very much reduced. We don't have time enough, until unless we have a rapid recognition, we may lose our mother. So for this, immediately we want to have a blood pressure maintained, for which electrolytes would help. Administer the oxygen to maintain the normal saturation, and intubation if necessary, and start CPR. Okay, because this is the emergency where we can lose the mother. So treat the hypotension with the electrolytes. Consider pulmonary artery catheterization. Trauma to the uterus can be further avoided. We are planning some other intrauterine pressure management gadgets to be applied. And if God forbid we need to have a perimortem cesarean section, then the insertion of the placenta should be avoided. So how we are going to manage? First, we need to have immediate and vigorous management. Give oxygen by face mask. Maintain the normal blood volume by the plasma and intravenous fluids till the blood arrives for you. Prevent the development of DIC. Keeping in view that the fresh frozen plasmas and fibrinogen products are available with us. Administer the whole blood and fibrinogen. Monitor the patient's vital signs. And deliver the fetus as soon as possible. So the second important complication which we are going to discuss today is about uterine inversion. As the name indicates, what does it mean? It means the uterus has become inside and out. In the simple words, in the layman language, if somebody tells you what is a uterine inversion, you would definitely say it means the uterus is coming inside out, isn't it? So, but what do you think when it would happen? It is the most important complication, although alhamdulillah, unfortunately, it is a rare one. It happens in the third stage of labor. It can happen in the third stage of labor where we are delivering the placenta. So the mismanagement, some of the basic steps which we take during the active management of third stage of labor, if they are mismanaged, then the risk of uterine inversion will increase. So it occurs when the placenta fails to detach from the uterus as it exits, pulls on the inside surface and turns the organ inside out. This is what I was telling you, that inversion means to become something inside out. So the uterus has also become inside out. Like if it is pulled so vigorously without stabilizing at the fundus. So what is our one of the most important steps in the management of third stage of labor is that we place a left hand on the uterine fundus and gentle traction to the placenta while we are giving traction to deliver the placenta, or it is known as controlled cord traction. If this step is mismanaged, there is no support given to the uterine fundus and it is pulled vigorously instead of giving a controlled contraction, then we can have an organ inside out. It is called the uterine inversion. It is potentially fatal, childbirth complications, and with the maternal, but it has a good survival rate, although the morbidity for the mother is troublesome. The incidence is about 1 in 20,000 deliveries. See, this is what it happens. This is the vaginal wall, and you can see the uterus has become inside out. The uterus has become, and this is a constriction ring. You see, this is a constriction ring which has developed, which will prevent this uterus to be replaced inside. Can you imagine now? This is a constriction ring, and it will prevent the uterus to be again replaced inside its normal position. So the exact cause of inversion is unknown, but as I told you, the mismanagement of the third stage of labor can be affected. Similarly, the uterus which are very lax, the multiparous patients, when the placenta is adherent or some part of it is adherent in the fundus, these are all the risk factors for it. So a strong traction on the umbilical cord, particularly when the placenta is in a fundal location during the third stage of labor. So you are pulling it, and on the other side, the placenta is adherent. So what will happen? Because of that strong pull, the uterus will become inside and out. You can see here, it's the same thing. This, the uterus has become inside out. And then what happens is that because of this constriction ring, as I have told you before, the replacement becomes definitely very problematic. And the important, most important thing is that when it happens, the hemorrhage is not much, but the vasovagal shock, the vagal shock which happens and the pain which is created is the shock which will definitely be of trouble for the lady. So this is a different degrees of uterine inversion. Dimpling of the fundus remains above the internal os. You can see this is the internal os and it is above. In the second case, the fundus passes through the cervix but lies inside the vagina. It has not broken or become the inside out. In the third stage, it is outside the vulva, and then it can also become inside out. So how is the diagnosis? The uterus protrudes from the vagina. The fundus doesn't seem to be in its proper vision. The uterus protrudes from the vagina. This you can see on the vaginal examination as you look at it. And when you go on the abdominal examination, as normally a fundus should be palpated after delivery around the level of umbilicus as a round globular organ. But if the fundus doesn't seem to be in its proper position, it is not felt in the abdominal cavity, then we suspect of inversion. The mother experiences pain and shock out of proportion to the blood loss. This is very important. She is experiencing pain and shock out of proportion to the blood loss. The mother's blood pressure drops, mainly due to hypertension, not because of the blood loss, but because of the vagal effect. And the mother shows signs due to vagal shock. This is very important. As you have also seen before, that most of the 90% of the complications of the pregnancy or the childbirth or at the time of delivery are related to postpartum hemorrhage. But this complication, on the other hand, shows the signs of vagal shock. So how you are going to help? The immediate you know about it, the better it is for us, because we will prevent the constriction ring to happen, prevent it, and then it can be gently reduced inside. This is a very important. As early as it is recognized, it is better for the lady, because the constriction ring would not have yet been developed, and you are able to reduce the uterus inside. And after replacement, the hand should remain inside the uterus until the uterus becomes contracted by parenteral oxytocin. So if the constriction ring has not yet developed, otherwise it will become very hard for you to replace it. So as early as it is recognized and gently it is reduced back, and then the hand is kept inside, so the reinversion doesn't happen and then parenteral oxytocins are given. The placenta, if the placenta is still adhering to it, as we have seen in the business pictures, the placenta was not adherent. If the placenta is still adherent to it, then you should. This is also the key point in the management. The placenta remains attached. We are not going to pull the placenta if the uterine inversion has happened. This you should not forget. The placenta is never ever removed or tried to remove if an inversion happens, until and unless the inversion is replaced and then the placenta is removed. You may need treatment of shock, including blood transfusion, fluids, painkillers as required. So this is how you can replace manually. You can see this is a uterine inversion. This is how we are trying to remove it, to replace it manually, and then we are we are keeping our fist inside so the reinversion doesn't happen, and the uterotonics are given so that the uterus remains contracted in its place. So this is one of the management options. Second comes, if this cannot be happened, then hydrostatic pressure by Usselman, which was devised by Usselman, in which about 2 liters of warm water are placed by a vacuum cup, as we use in vacuum delivery, and the warm water under a hive in a drip is hang, and then by silicone vacuum cup, this warm water is pushed inside to the uterus, and then it is pushed and replaced back into the abdominal cavity. So this is the second method which you can use. So after the shock, we can help the patient by giving her a good painkiller, raise the foot end of the bed, replace the uterus and the if it is not possible with us, then it should be replaced by under general anesthesia or by giving the uterine relaxing agents. This is very important. So the other surgical methods, as we have told you, the first two methods were by manual replacement or by hydrostatic pressure. And if the manual replacement is quite difficult, then we can give uterine relaxants such as prebutaline and then try to replace it again. If all are unsuccessful manually, then we go for the surgical procedure by performing laparotomy. The first is the Puttington method. It is mentioned in your textbooks as well. The anus of Babcock clamp is placed on each round ligament of the uterus, and then the inverted is 2 centimeter deep into the inverted fundus. Clamping and traction are repeated until the inversion is corrected. And this procedure is similar to the hand over hand movement using when pulling up an anchor line, like we do in a tug of war as well. So a second operator with the hand in the vagina can apply upper pressure on the fundus to facilitate the procedure. And the second method is the Holter method. It involves making an incision in the lower uterine segment to bisect the inversion ring, the constricting ring, as I told you before, and facilitating the replacement of the fundus by a Puttington method. So Holter procedure is from the pelvic area, and it is accompanied and helped by the Huntington procedure from abdominal side. So the posterior lower uterine segment can be incised to avoid aterogenic system. So you should not forget, for the uterine inversion, the important key point for the take-home message is prevention, treatment of shock by painkillers, fluids, and also relaxing the patient. Trying to manually replace the uterus, if it is not helpful, we can give hand relaxants. If this is not helpful, then we can use the hydrostatic pressure. And if these procedures fail, then the surgical method of Puttington and Holter can help us. And if all these procedures, God forbid, are not helpful to us, then by laparotomy, the hysterectomy can be carried out to save the life of the mother. So these are all the management which we are going to do for this lady. Okay. So now the other most important and life-threatening complication for the mother is the ruptured uterus. It is the most serious complication in obstetrics. It is often fatal for the fetus and may also be responsible for the death of the mother. A ruptured uterus can happen, which is the most important risk factor in our locality, in our social aspects, is when a grand multipara lady is given a judicious use of prostaglandins, misoprostol, or oxytocin during labor, or a lady with the previous cesarean sections are given trial which are unattended and unobserved for. So what's a uterine rupture? It is a disruption in the continuity of all uterine layers, endometrium, myometrium, and serosa, any time beyond 28 weeks of pregnancy. So the incidence varies widely, from 1 in 2000 to 1 in 200 delivery. You can see how much variable it is, because of the fact that in the developing and underdeveloping countries, grand multiparity and then trial of labors with unsupervised conditions and judicious use of uterotonic agents all lead to this catastrophic event. So what happens, you see, this is a scar, especially a uterine rupture in a previous scar. A uterine rupture in a lady who had a previous cesarean section. And then what can happen is a previous incision site for cesarean delivery. There is initial tearing along the previous scar. Or if it is not picked up earlier, then it can lead to full thickness tear of the anterior uterine wall and the blood flowing out into the abdomen. So the types of tear can be complete. In a complete rupture, the peritoneum, endometrium, myometrium, and the serosa, as well as the peritoneum tears and the contents of the maternal mother's uterus fill into the peritoneum cavity. The fetal mortality rate increases dramatically after this period. In an incomplete rupture, the mother's peritoneum remains intact. This peritoneum acts the channel for blood vessels and nerves. An incomplete uterine rupture is also it is significantly less dangerous for fewer complications to deliver the delivery process. Another term which we should also be understanding is the dehiscence of the uterine scar. The previous agent section is the uterine scar has a dehiscence in which the uterine scar is has given way, but still the fetal membranes are intact. The fetus is intact inside the uterine cavity. Like you can say, it can be a sign of imminent rupture as well. This is known as dehiscence. So what is the etiology further for uterine rupture? It is further divided into spontaneous, like there was no previous, the patient was not in labor, she had no uterotonic agents given, but there was spontaneous rupture. There can be a scar rupture, like previous labial suction, and then it happened, or iatrogenic. This is the one I'm telling you, where we are going to give, the people are giving injudicious use of uterotonic agents on a scar uterus or on a grand multi para where the uterus is already thinned out, where the uterus is already unable to tolerate the stress of labor. So during the pregnancy, there can be done into the uterine cavity, and now after the labor process, the uterine contraction is further thinned out the uterine walls. And during labor, there can be obstructed rupture due to the obstructed labor and non-obstructed rupture due to the weakening of the walls and repeated previous births. This is again the same that we saw seen before, the previous scar ruptures. So what are the iatrogenic? The same thing, there is injudicious use of oxytocin and other uterotonic agents, or there can be other procedures which you could carry out during the labor. Internal pudendal purging in a grand multi para 3D, manual removal of placenta, there is a use of forceps, or there is a breech extraction, and the uterus is also thinned out due to the labor process and the grand multi para. They can also be predisposing factors, but keeping in view, the most important one is the injudicious use of uterotonics. Or if a previous scar patient is given a trial of labor without proper monitoring. So what are the signs and symptoms? It can be abdominal pain and tenderness, shock, vaginal bleeding, undetectable fetal heartbeat, palpable fetal body parts. Definitely, why we are going to have a palpable fetal body parts? Because no more the uterine contour is lost. The uterine contour is lost. Therefore, we are going to feel about the fetal body parts. As the uterine processes. There will be cessation of contractions and signs of intraperitoneal bleeding. What are the signs of intraperitoneal bleeding? Whenever there is a blood inside of the peritoneal cavity, it can lead to there can be signs of fetal when there are the signs of intraperitoneal bleeding will lead to abdominal pain and the pain under the diaphragm. The most common sign, sudden appearance of fetal distress during labor. And then there can be a complete laceration of the uterine wall. There can be sharp pain between contractions, and the contraction is slow. Baby's head moving back up to the birth canal because there no more the uterine contour is maintained. Uterus is ruptured already. Bulging under the abdominal exam, you can feel the baby's head under the. uterine wall. So, bulging at the pubic bone, the baby's head has protruded outside the uterine scar. Uterine atony and loss of the uterine muscle tone. And maternal tachycardia with a rapid heart rate and hypotension. So, what are the signs we are going to pick? Like, mother can have tachycardia. She can have signs of shock or abdominal examination. The fetal heart rate will be affected. There can be bradycardia or fetal demise. The uterine control will be lost. We can directly feel about the fetal body parts rather than the uterine control. And there will be bulging of the baby's head under the pubic bone. And on pelvic examination, there will be recession of the baby's head. So this is in the order where you can pick the signs of uterine rupture. If a lady comes to you and she has very suspect, a strong suspicion of uterine rupture, she's in a state of shock, previous history of, cesarean section, and now a prolonged obstructive labor. So, and now she has come in a state of shock. You are same way, you are not feeling much about the fetal control, the uterine control. Or if there is an incomplete rupture, we may be able to feel the uterine contour, but the fetal heart rate is lost and there can be bradycardia. So in all these conditions, you have a strong suspicion of uterine rupture. So it can be complete, incomplete, or maybe a scar dehiscence. So a painful bleeding and loss of fetal heart sound will confirm. Ultrasonography, by the time you are preparing for the patient, you can have your further help by extra peritoneal hematoma, appearance of it, free peritoneal blood, empty uterus, and a gestational sac of the fetus is outside the uterus. So what are the management plan? The most important thing is the intensive resuscitation, then emergency nephrectomy, followed by prospective antibiotics and adequate post-operative care. So what is the intensive resuscitation? We are going to correct the hypovolemia which has happened due to hemorrhage, sepsis, dehydration if she previously had a prolonged labor. Intravenous broad spectrum antibiotics should be helped further. Monitor to ensure fluid and the blood replacement and the blood volume expansion may worsen the bleeding from damaged vessels. So, the important thing is it should be immediately dealt with that nephrectomy. So what are the options which we can have if the rupture is repairable? It should be repaired. The uterus should be conserved. But if the rupture is irreparable, the uterus is lax and you are not going to gain any benefit from the repair, a subtotal or total hysterectomy should be carried out. So at the same time, the uterine repair is done. The rupture is not extensive and it has just helped us good enough, then our repair is done and the family is complete, it should be followed by sterilization so that the mother is not in a jeopardy or danger for the next pregnancy. So the same thing which I've told you before, we should be aware of the predisposing factors. And then if there are signs and symptoms, we should be vigilant for monitoring the maternal blood pressure, pulse, respiration, monitor fetal heart in a lady which is being given prior after a previous cesarean section, or a gland multiple where a lady, even she had previous vaginal deliveries, if she is being given a trial now. For her management, if it does happen, then obtain blood for excess, cross-matching, administered oxygen, plated airway, circulating volumes are given, and then manage on the surgical options. So the next complication which we can encounter, the next obstetrical emergency which we are going to discuss is about cord prolapse. This is the emergency which I would say has a more acute, drastic or fatal effect for the fetus, and for the mother, less likely. So as the previous two videos of uterine rupture, they were fatal for the mother and for the fetus, both of them. But this emergency, that is cord prolapse, it could be or it can prove to be fatal for the fetus more and morbidity can be increased for the mother in case of operative intervention. Otherwise, it is fatal for the fetus. If unattended, unrecognized, or and could not be treated on time. So there are three clinical types of abnormal descent of the umbilical cord by the side of the presenting part, like this cord prolapse. So what do you mean and understand with the presentation? When cord is slipped down below the presenting part and is lying in the intact back of membranes, and the cord is lying in the intact back, and the cord is attached to the when cord is slipped down below the presenting part and is felt lying in the intact bagel by the fingers of the internal examination. The cord is placed by the side of the presenting part and is not felt by the fingers of the internal examination. This it is inside the vagina or outside of the mouth following rupture of the membrane. So don't forget all these three conditions. In the cord presentation, it is felt by the examiner and the membranes are there. In a cord collapse, we are not feeling it, but the problem is it is lying with the presenting part. But in cord collapse, the membranes have been ruptured and the cord is lying inside the vagina. Cord is along the presenting part. This is the cord presentation. In both these cases, the membranes are still intact. Here we can feel it, and in the first one, we are not able to appreciate it. It is hidden from us. And this is cord collapse. The cord has fallen out through the ruptured membranes and is lying inside the vagina. So, how the cord, always remember when the cord is not able to stay inside because the fetal head or the fetal presenting part is not occupying or snugly fitting the lower uterine segment. Don't forget this. If the presenting part is snugly fitting the lower uterine segment, then the risk and chance of cord collapse is very less likely. Wherever there is a malpresentation, this can lead to more risk of cord collapse and cord malpresentations. So you can see there's a transverse lie or breach, there's a contracted pelvis, prematurity, twins, adenomas, placental factor, they can all lead to risk of for malformations. Cryptogenic, when a low rupture of membrane is done, if the head is high or the presenting part is not snugly or fitting the lower jawline segment. Or if a stabilizing reduction is done in case of a malpresentation, and in that case, the fraud collapses or becomes lying in an occult position. As I have told you before, the diagnosis is difficult and it can be the general examination. The part presentation can be assessed, but the bulk prolapse, as the name indicates, is difficult to diagnose. So, what is the management? The protocol is guided by the following three steps. Always remember, in a case of part prolapse or a part presentation, the protocol is guided by three things. The fetus is still alive or not? What is the maturity of the fetus? And what is the degree of dilatation of the cervix? In a cord presentation, if the fetus is still alive, and if the uterus is, and the cervical dilatation is controlled enough, that is, there is no immediate, we are going to see that the patient is going to deliver, that is, cervical section is indicated. Once the diagnosis is made, if immediate vaginal delivery is not possible, then the best option is cervical section. In a rare occasion, if there is a multi-para lady, if she is 78 cm dilated and there is doubt of the distress, and we anticipate that the vagina delivery will happen, we can go for it. In case of cord collapse, first we should make sure that the baby is alive or not. And in this case, the cesarean section is carried out if the baby is living. And we can also help while they are preparing for cesarean section by elevating the presenting part, by filling the bladder so that the cord is not compressed. This is the main cornerstone that we both want to have a cord compressed, just to prevent the hypoxia for the fetus and the fetal distress. So for this case, we'll have to lift the presenting part of the cord. Postural treatment can also be given, and to replace the cord inside the vagina should not be done manually. So if the fetus is no more alive, then we should proceed and await for the spontaneous delivery. So in conclusion, I would like to discuss is that the management of emergency is usually the responsibility of hospital obstetrician, but as more the maternity care is not given in community, however, midwives, general practitioners and paramedics may be involved and must be aware of the guidelines and outlines for this. So another important obstetric contribution which I would like to discuss with you is complication which we can encounter is shoulder dystocia. So, for the shoulder dystocia, we can define it. It requires additional obstetric maneuvers to release the shoulder after gentle downward traction has failed. While delivering the fetus, if additional obstetric maneuvers are given to release the shoulder after gentle downward gentle downward traction is failed. It occurs when the fetal anterior shoulder, or less commonly the posterior shoulder, impacts against the maternal symphysis or sacral promontory following delivery of the vertex. It is an obstetric emergency which is one of the most primary events in labor. It is unpredictable and unpreventable event. The incidence is around 0.2-3% of all vaginal deliveries. In 16% of cases of shoulder dystocia, there are conventional risk factors which are responsible. But unfortunately, most of the shoulder dystocias happen, which are unpredicted and unpreventable. So in these cases, the existing risk factors this should be discussed, as well as we should be always aware and having good drills that when it happens in unpredictable cases, it should be and it can be managed. So there are risk factors and anticipations about it. Only 25% of solar sources have at least one of the risk factors. In the maternal case, there can be abnormal pelvic anatomy, short stature of the mother, diabetes related complications, and increased maternal BMI. In the middle case, suspected macrosomia, labor related can be excessive vaginal delivery, induction of labor, prolonged active phase of labor, secondary arrest, and the augmentation of labor. Again, I would like to emphasize that fetal macrosomia can happen only in 48% of cases, responsible as the responsible for the shoulder dystocia. On the other hand, even less than 3.5 kg of the weight can lead to shoulder dystocia. So clinical fetal weight estimation is unreliable, and third the surface of the also carries a 10% margin of assessment of weight. So how we can prevent it? Especially diabetic mothers of insulin, they can have a good control of their diabetes. Just help to prevent us from macrosomia and can also lead to prevention of shoulder dystocia. In ladies with suspected macrosomia, elective cesarean section can be offered. But it is not recommended in routine until unless there are previous histories and risk factors which modify our plan. So how to diagnose in labor? Difficulty of the delivery of the face and chin. Difficulty with the delivery of the face and chin. The head remaining tightly applied to the vulva or even infected, which is the genital side. Failure of the restitution of the fetal head. And failure of the shoulders to descend. Please remember all these signs which are diagnostic in labor of shoulder dystocia. You can see this picture. See, this is the head which is snugly applied to the maternal vulva. This is a turtle sign. This is a turtle sign. The shoulder dystocia becomes obvious when the fetal head emerges and then refills the place of the perineum, commonly referred to as the turtle sign. So this complication should be effectively managed so as to avoid hypoxia and acidosis to the fetus, and also carefully to avoid unnecessary trauma to the mother and the fetus. So what's the intrapartum management? The most important intrapartum management factor is that obstetricians will anticipate this morbidity to happen. There should be help vision. Obstetricians to stand by at second stage of labor when the shoulder dystocia is anticipated. However, it is recognized that all the cases can be anticipated and there are all but attendants which are ready and having good drills regarding shoulder dystocia. This is the morning which my dear students you should always remember. This is also a mnemonic from ALSO, Advanced Life Supporting Obstetrics. Call for help. Evaluate for episiotomy. This evaluation for episiotomy is not mandatory. Legs. This is the thing we are going to discuss in detail also. Macroberts maneuver. External pressure, which is the supraclavicular pressure. Enter inside the vagina for the rotational maneuvers. Remove the posterior arm or rolling over the patient through her hands and knees. So don't forget this morning, helper. So help of the senior midwives, MOs, OBG consultants, and pediatrics. Evaluate for episiotomy. It is not mandatory, but in episiotomy, help us to do internal maneuvers. Always remember, in episiotomy, help us to do internal maneuvers and help us to further carry out the directions. This is very important. My dear students, 85 to 90% of the cases can be resolved with this maneuver. This is the Mac-Roberts maneuver. We are flexing the legs and the thighs and having abduction at the thighs as well. So, flexion and abduction. What this will help us? It strengthens the lumbosacral angle, rotates the maternal pelvis cephalad, and is associated with an increase in the uterine pressure and amplitude. The Mac-Roberts maneuver is the single most effective intervention with reported cases of around 90% of the successful management of shoulder dysplasia. Make Roberts maneuver. Make sure the maternal bladder is empty, and with the mother can have sat or doing, then the attendants can help her flex her legs, flex her thighs at the her legs at the hip joint. This is very important. Flex her legs at the hip joint. Maternal pressure should never be applied. Maternal pressure should be discontinued. This is very important while you are managing it. The maternal pressure should not be applied, and the maternal pressure should be discouraged. The pressure. The key part of the heparin anion, in which the maternal abdomen, we are applying supraclavicular pressure so that the anterior shoulder can be disconnected from under the symphysis penis. This is the vaginal maternal. The next aim for entering inside and giving the internal maneuvers so that the diameter of the anterior shoulder is reduced. These are called the Ribbon Q maneuver. Indicated, and if the shoulders move into oblique diameter, then they attack the hip. Moving the shoulders in oblique diameter will reduce their diameter. Similarly, in a wood spray maneuver also, the baby is trying to move in the opposite direction, just keeping in mind that the diameter is reduced of the bisexual diameter is removed or is reduced and the baby is syncopated. That comes the last arm, the removal of the posterior arm. It is one of the easiest part in which can help us to reduce the diameter and then deliver the baby. The delivery of the posterior arm. The previous maneuvers were more directly towards the delivery for the anterior arm and thus reducing the diameter of the bisacromial diameter. And in this case, we can deliver the posterior arm and thus then facilitating the delivery of the posterior. So this is how this posterior arm is held from the anticapital fossa and then delivered, and then this helps to ease out. So roll out the patient's shoulder, hands and knees or poor position. It is in 83% cases in one of, but at the time of labor it seems to be quite difficult for the lady to adopt this position. So if all these procedures fail, what are the third line maneuvers which can reduce the maternal morbidity? These are cleidotomy, in which the clavicle is tried to be broken, the fetal clavicle, so that the delivery can be helped out. But these are all destructive maneuvers, which are less likely to be helpful, and they carry out more of the morbidity for the mother in the fetus. Symphysiotomy, in which the ligament between the symphysis pubis is separated and tried to make more space and deliver the anterior shoulder. Or the semi-dual maneuver, in which the fetal head is reduced back into the vagina and then delivered by cesarean section. But keep in view, the 7-8 maneuver is only helpful if the fetal cord has not been cut yet. So these are all the procedures, but always remember that the risk of postpartum hemorrhage and third and tears for the mother is greatest of all these procedures, as well as the shoulder dysplasia itself. I would like to leave with you and always remember for the matter of fetal morbidity, the risk of making it injury. The postpartum hemorrhage for the mother, the third and fourth tears, uterine ruptures, disease in circulation, and the vaginal dysplasia are the important and dreadful complications. On the fetal side, the bleeding plexus palsy, clavicle fracture, fracture of the uterus, fetal hypoxia with permanent neurological deficit, and fetal demise are all the complications which we can encounter. So, in this complication, the most important, least but not last but not the least, is the documentation. While doing all the procedures, the documentation carries a very great importance. Which number was applied and for how long it was applied. Because the neurological deficit which got it happens to the fetus for the brachial plexus or for the neurological deficit, they can all be documented on the basis of the documentation and for the time. So it is important for the time of the implant, the collection of the hepatitis species, finding in the sequence. Time of delivery of the body, star parentages, condition of the baby in the umbilical cord, that is measured. Thank you very much to the students for listening to us, and I hope all the five most important obstetrical emergencies we have read today and dealt today will be a great help for you for your understanding, for your clinical and your theoretical understanding of cord collapse, uterine rupture, embolism, uterine inversion, and shoulder dystrophy.